Well, good morning. It is good to see everybody in God's house this morning. What a wonderful day He's given us to come into His house to praise and worship Him this morning. We're going to start as we normally do. We're going to have some words from Scripture on the screen, and we would like to invite you all to stand with us as we declare God's Word together in His house this morning. So let's stand together and put a big smile on our face as we come before Him and declare His Word. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it.
Amen. Man. And you know what amen means? So be it. It's saying yes. Praise God. I say yes to the Lord. What do you say this morning? How great is our God? I'll tell you, He's greatly to be praised. And He tells us, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord, praise ye the Lord. And boy, I tell you what, it's warming up outside. And it's been warm for the last several days, and it's going to be warm through the week. But we've got a great and mighty God today. I'm glad this is the hottest I'll ever have it. Amen. Better days ahead. Praise the Lord. Thank you for coming to the house of the Lord today. I do pray that your heart will be blessed. And today we're continuing. We've got two messages left to preach on the five solas. And we've talked about, of course, grace alone, faith alone, in Christ alone. And today we're dealing with by the Scriptures alone. And next week we'll finalize that series. And you go back to the 16th century. Protestant, what is called the Protestant Reformation, Martin Luther. And of course, this declaration was made. What is it saying? It is saying salvation is by Christ. And hallelujah, I am glad that He today is our Savior, our Lord, our Master. And not only that, but He is our coming King. And I don't know about you, but my prayer is, even so come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Let me just ask you a quick question, simply by an extended hand. How many of you today have got needs, burdens in your life, and you just need some prayer today, simply as a declaration today before the Lord? Just slip your hand up right now and say, pray. Pray, please, Pastor. I appreciate the prayers. Amen. See, God sees in the need. He knows your heart, and He's going to meet that need today. Father, we come into your presence with thanksgiving. We enter into your courts with praise. We come in the blessed name, the glorious name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, and we declare and we proclaim, how great is our God. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you, Lord, for saving us. Thank you, Lord, for supplying our every need. Thank you, Lord, for being a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Thank you that your grace is sufficient. Thank you that, Lord, you meet everything in our life. You crown us with loving kindness and tender mercies. You redeem our souls. You encourage us each day. You put food on our table and you put clothes upon our back. You give us a place to call home. You give us a church to worship in. You give us great friends that we can serve you with. And Lord, we'll just bless beyond measure. We know today that you truly are a good God. And we thank you, Lord. I believe some folks in here believe today you are a good God and that they are blessed by the Lord. I pray that each heart's need will be met today as folks just raise their hands for the burdens upon their heart today. We know that we have a sufficient God who will meet that need today. You said, cast your every care upon you. And Lord, cast our every care upon you because you care for us. Lord, we not only cast our cares upon you, but we today lift up our praises before you. And we today just didn't come today, Lord, to bring our shopping list of burdens and needs, but we've also come today to lift our hearts, to lift our hands, and to lift our voices in praise and adoration. Have your way in this place. We rebuke every force of evil that would try to come against any person in this room, any person connected with this ministry. And Lord, we claim the power of our God that greater is He that is within us than he that is within this world. Thank you that we've got Jesus who is our friend that sticks closer than a brother. Have your way in the service. Bless Tom as he leads us. And Lord, when we come down to everything said, done, and accomplished today, may all the glory come before you as we lift up our voices in praise to your glorious presence today. Have your way, and we'll thank you and praise you, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. All God's children said, amen.
So tall, and you realize life's not always fair. You run away and hide, let the old man decide, or you can change your circumstances with a prayer. When everything falls, have a broken heart, just raise your hands and say, Lord, you're all I need, you're everything to me, and you'll take the pain away. When it seems
this morning. Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages, let His praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God.
Now, why don't you shake hands, hug necks, let somebody know you're glad to see him in church today. Hi, everyone. So glad you're with us here at Gethsemane Baptist Church. Well, I tell you, great things are happening at GBC. Last Sunday night, we baptized a bunch of folks. Today, we're going to be participating in Holy Communion. And boy, we're here in the July 4th celebration. And wow, it's just awesome to be in God's house right here at Gethsemane Baptist Church. I would love for you to come and experience what God's doing in this great ministry. Come see us. We'd love to have you. 411 Blue Ridge Street, located right here in the beautiful Lynchburg, Virginia. Today, we're preaching in the fourth message of five messages on the five solas, and we're going to be dealing with today on the issue of Scripture alone. So stay tuned for the message, and I pray today you have received the Lord as your Savior and you know Him in free pardon of sin, and I pray you are blessed today. If you're not, come on over here. We'd love to bless you. God bless you today. Sail by the living word of God, I shall prevail. I'm standing on the promises of God. Oh, I'm standing on the promises of God, my Savior. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, and to Him eternally the love strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God, we're standing on the promises of God, my Savior. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call. In all, I'm standing on the promises of God. Where I'm standing, I'm standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. I'm standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. We're going to give you a chance to get back to your seat. We're going back to sing that chorus one more time, but please get back to your seat in a hurry. Amen. I'm standing.
Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence.
Give your Bibles. I want you to turn to the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. And today we're dealing with a subject of the scripture alone. I really believe today something that's very vital that's missing within our churches, our homes, and our lives is the Word of God. I just believe today that we're not putting the emphasis on God's Word that we need to put. We just bring our Bibles to church. We take them home. We put them on the places at home, like the coffee tables or whatever, and wherever you keep your Bible. And we have our Bibles, but I don't think we're really using our Bibles the way that God intended for us to use them, that they are part of our life every day. And so, you know, the Word of God is the most precious gift that you've got apart from salvation. As a matter of fact, it's this book that was vital in bringing salvation to your heart and your life. So you need this book, because not only is it necessary today to bring you into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, but then it becomes unnecessary for your living every day. Everything that you need to know about life, blessings, and heaven is right here. Every problem can be solved through the pages of this book. Every encouragement that you need is provided through this book. Every solution for your life is found in this book. Everything that you will ever need in this life and for eternity is right here in this book. And folks, if we don't use it, then who suffers? We do. But I'm glad God gave us such a marvelous gift called the Word of God. all around the words ever spoken, we find the Word of God. We think about all the words that people have said, all the words that we've read, all the things that we've seen. But there is none today that is more precious than the Word of God, which is alive and powerful. And the Bible will bring the power of God into your life. So when you read the Bible, you tap into what is called life-changing force that will direct your life to God and refine your life and improve your life. You want a better life? I tell you, you'll find it right here in the Bible. And if you don't have a Bible, you let me know. I will personally give you a Bible. I want everybody that comes in this church to have a Bible. Yes, we put scripture on screen and so forth, music on screen, but that does not substitute today. You need this book. You need the Bible, and you need to read it every day. You need to apply it every day. You've got to do as Paul told Timothy. You've got to study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth. That's the Bible. That's God's word. Now today, listen, I want you to understand that God promises certain things today to those who will take time each day to know him. And you know him through the word of God. If you're not reading the Bible, I'm going to tell you right now, you don't know God. You've got to be in the word to learn of God and to understand God and to really realize how magnificent and great our God is. So I jotted down several things today that will help you to know the things that God has in his word for us. The first thing is, you know, through the pages of God's word, we have something that's lacking in a lot of people's lives, and that's called joy. I didn't say happiness, because happiness comes and happiness goes. But the joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord remains today. It's like a transplant. It takes a transplant from the scriptures into your heart, and then you receive the joy of the Lord. Boy, if you're going through some deep waters, it'll lift you up. If you're facing some decisions and troubles in your life, it will help you. I'm telling you today, this book reeks with the joy of the Lord. Amen. Not only does it give you joy today, but it gives you strength. It will bring the strength of God into your life. God's word builds you up. People go to gyms and other places to try to build up the muscles and develop those triceps and biceps and pectoral muscles and try to look like they've been chiseled out of stone and all that stuff. But we ignore our lives from the standpoint of God's word. If you want a real workout that will build you up and make you strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, I point you to this called the word of God. It will not only bring joy, it will bring strength. Not only will it bring joy and strength, but it will bring peace. This book is saturated with the peace of God. And when you receive the Lord into your heart and your life, you receive a peace that will exceed or surpass any understanding today. Peace in the midst of the storms of life. Peace when seemingly things are falling apart. Jesus said, "My peace I give unto you." You know how you get it? You get it in a relationship, and you get it through the word of God. And then the last thing, the fifth thing, is success. Answered prayers will bring success. You know what happens with the word of God? It draws you into a place of prayer. You know, you spend time in prayer. Oh, I do. But I also spend time in the word. As a matter of fact, I take prayer and the word and I blend them together. And the result is God brings success to my life. He brings encouragement. He brings strength. He brings direction. He brings everything that this book contains. If you're looking today for something that will change your life, there is no greater place to find it. Now, listen, there are a lot of great books out there. There are a lot of great things that you can listen to, read, etc. But there is none greater than the Word of God. Amen. This is the book that will change your life. Amen. Because the author of this book is God Almighty, and he's in life-changing. Amen. He's about changing your life, changing your eternity, and blessing you today. And folks, you will never go wrong with the pages of God's Word. For the past several weeks now, we have been preaching on in the Sunday morning service about, and we've taken a break from the book of Genesis. But what I've been trying to give you this year, and even into part of last year, I'm trying to give you some of the basics of your belief system, because I think sometimes we forget those things, or we are really not plugged into those things, and therefore we really don't have a great comprehension of what God wants to do in our life through the basics of his word. But we find that something happened in the, you go back to the days of Martin Luther, and you look at what is called the five solas, S-O-L-A-S. And here is what the core beliefs of what it really means to be a Christian. You know, folks, we're looking for all the fluff, but you listen, you need the core of what it means to be a Christian. You need the strength. You need today to be put on this rock of ages today that not only changes your life, but I'm glad that he gives stability to your life today. And we found, and we have found in these five solas this, that we're saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, as I preached last Sunday. And then today we're talking about according to the scriptures alone, and also to the glory of God alone. That's next Sunday. So let me just today bring your attention to the fact today that in God's word is everything that you'll need in life and for eternity. Let's stand for the reading of God's word. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise. Hear what God's word does to you. It makes you wise, wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Then he declares, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God, that the person of God, may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Hallelujah. Thank God for his word. Let's give the Lord a praise. Amen. You may be seated. Realizing today within the church, people come from various church traditions, denominations, affiliations, and all those things that, you know, we are part of. Realizing that some of those churches are formal when it comes to their worship. Now, what is needed today in the church is an infallible, inspired declaration that is made by God and not man. Many of your churches today are hearing what man has to say, but they're ignoring what God has to say. Well, you know what the Bible says about all men? The Bible says all men are liars. I'll tell you, I don't want direction from a liar, do you? I want direction from the one true God today that will always give you the right direction that you need for your life. So when you realize this today, we need to know the Bible is the word of God. And we need to apply that word to our life. Recently in a meeting of the Minnesota Conference of the United Methodist Church, they have decided to edit what is called, I grew up with that, what is called the Apostles' Creed. Some of you have probably heard of that, right? Amen. But what they have done is they've removed all references today to God as Father. Well, what do you get when you take away God as Father? It's all gone. Folks, I don't know what's wrong with some of these denominations that they are taking today the Word of God and trying to twist it, and they're taking the things of God's Word that brings value to our life, and they're abandoning it. They've even here several years ago, they took the hymnal and they removed every song in the hymnal that had any association or connection to the blood of Jesus. We didn't want a slaughterhouse religion. Well, folks, if you don't have Jesus, you got a mess. And let me tell you what, you take the blood out of the Bible, you take God out of the Bible, you don't even have a cover, amen. Because this Bible says holy Bible because it's written by a holy God to give you encouragement to your life that you can realize this is what you build your life on, amen. So it's this grace today to the church that we're trying to take everything that represents holiness and righteousness and God and Christ and the blood and the virgin birth, the deity of Christ, and we are today removing those things from our foundation. I'm going to tell you what, you're going to have an empty religion that's going to lead you straight into the very bowels of hell. What you need is the power of God's word to transform your life. So we see today that what we're doing, we're losing our view on the authority of the Bible. 30 years ago, the Southern Baptist Conference or Convention, they teetered on the edge of theological liberalism. And I mean, they were basically theological, but not political. Listen, today, in all the denominations in which we see out there, they're trending towards a moderate-type belief system. They're compromising God's word. Now, I'm not attacking any church, but I'm going to tell you right now, we need to know what's right and we need to know what's wrong. And if it does not stand for the inerrancy and infallibility of this word, I don't want any part of it. And then we wonder why today people's lives are not changing and why God's not blessing. You know why? Because we've abandoned today the word, the day that will change our lives, our homes, and our families. You know why our family's on shaky ground? Because we've removed the power and the presence of God out of our homes. We wonder why our churches today are on shaky ground. We get up, pastors get up, and we'll read you some book, but they ignore the book called the Word of God. Folks, we need to get back to the principles that is found only in the pages of God's Word. What is happening is the church is losing a grip on the true inerrancy of Scripture today. So understand the entirety of the Bible is God's infallibility today, and today His Word is not an error found within it today. Now, you know, you may read God's Word, but I'm going to tell you how you can understand God's Word. I've had people say, I can't understand it. If you get to know the author and spend time in the Word and read God's Word and stay in the Word, you will understand the Word and you'll understand the author. Amen. Now, if that's the case today, and if you believe the book, the Bible, is sufficient today to give us all that we need, and let me just say that, it will give you all that you need today to know in the fact that God will work in your life. And today He will bring a saving way to your life that is called the Lord Jesus Christ. This book is an open declaration of the saving grace of our God. It started in the book of Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. It continued right on through to the end of Revelation chapter 22 when He says that the grace of God be with you. Folks, this Bible is complete. This Bible today is really God's breathed word. It's God breathing His life into your being today. It's God giving you hope. It's God giving you help. It's God giving you direction. It's God giving you everything that you need in life. And if you'll grab the Bible and start applying it to your life, you won't be drawn today into this moderate way of thinking today that is invaded, where they're rewriting the Bible and they're taking out the things today that we built our churches and our homes and our lives upon, and then we wonder why we are like we are. I'm going to stick with what God has said in His Word, and as far as I'm concerned, there's no greater version than the old-fashioned Holy King James Version, brother. It'll change your life. It'll change everything about you, and it will bless you beyond measure today. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to know today, as a preacher of the gospel today, the Bible must be the centerpiece of every message that I preach. I spent a lot of time in preparation. I don't just get up here and give you something fly by night off the cuff. I spend time in study to give you today the Word of God that will transform your life. Not only is it necessary in my preparation of what I preach to you, but also today, as a Christian, the Bible must be the centerpiece of our lives. If you're omitting the Bible, your life is going to be a failure. Honestly today, you have to really tie your life to the trustworthiness of God's Word. So the Bible is, let's establish a fact here. The Bible is the very Word of God. So when you hear the Bible, you know what you're doing? You're not hearing from the White House. You're hearing from God. And folks, we need to hear from God. Amen. The church, their homes, their families, we need to hear from God. And when you open the power of this book and start reading it and studying it and applying it, it will bring about what God has said. It'll breathe on you, amen, the power of Almighty God. Let me show you several things today. God's Word is God's message for all people, just not the Baptists. It's God's message for all people. Because the word says all that will come to him, he will in no wise cast out. I'm glad that's the word. I'm glad for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's God's word. God's word says he will heal you. God says he will bless you. God says he will supply your every need. God's word says he'll be your anchor in the storms of life. God's word says today you'll have a friend that will never leave you nor forsake you. God's word says you're established and built upon a rock. God's word says today you've got hope. And this world is falling apart. Thank God we're on the rock of ages, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm listening one day for that glorious call from heaven. Come up hither in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we shall be changed. That's the Bible. And this world is going to be facing something, I believe, soon and very soon. It's called the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's declared in 22 chapters of the book of the Revelation. And folks, today, thank God, when you go to chapters 4 and 5, you find that God talks about the rapture of the church. Then from 6 to 19, he talks about a time that is called the tribulation. And if you're not saved, you're going to go through it. And he talks about in chapter 20 about that there will be a day when every Christ rejecter will stand before the great white throne of judgment. I haven't rejected God. If you haven't received him, you have. You've got to know him in free pardon of sin. And then he tells us about a kingdom age. He talks about a place that is called heaven, where the walls are jasper and, thank God, precious stones, gates of pearl, place of mansions. But most importantly, I'll tell you what's in heaven. It's Jesus, amen. We will see the one that died for us and paid the price for us. And I can't wait to that day, hallelujah. And all because God's word declares it. I can know the pattern for my life. I can know the plan for my life. I can know how to live by faith. I can know how to receive the grace of God. Oh, folks, listen, I could go on the rest of the day about this. You say, well, preach, not today. Well, maybe not. Well, number one, the Bible is all about Jesus Christ. So in verse 15, Paul used the term Holy Scripture. And he's referring not only to the scripture of the New Testament, but he's referring to the Old Testament. Don't let anyone tell you today the Old Testament is no good for today. Oh, it is. It is. You say, yeah, but we don't live by the Ten Commandments. You need us as a standard. Maybe we'd have a lot of less trouble in our culture and society today if we'd start taking those ten and living by them. Amen. The aim of Holy Scriptures was a twofold process, according to verse 15. One, to make you wise unto salvation. Wise people receive Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. So the fool, the Bible says, hath said in his heart, there is no God. So the Bible points us to Christ that awakens a wisdom within you that will lead you to salvation. I'm going to tell you, every one of you in this room, every person on planet Earth, every person needs to be saved by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. You're not going to get there on church affiliation. You're not going to get there on your good. You're not going to get there on how much you know or where you work or your family lineage or anything good about you. When we baptized these folks last Sunday, that was a step after salvation. That does not get them into heaven. Folks, you've got to come by the way of the blood. And today, you don't know when your life will be gone. The Bible says your life is as a vapor. It appears for a little while and whoop, it's gone. Instantly. With no notice. We face death. But I can tell you today, if you've accepted Christ as your personal Savior, you can face it with confidence. Because you have been redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible points us to Christ. And that awakens that wisdom that we all must be saved. That God has provided salvation for every person. The Bible doesn't provide just salvation today. The Bible today also points to salvation and says, you must come this way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. The second thing is provided through faith in Christ Jesus. So thank God you can receive him. For by grace are you saved through faith. That being the case, the scripture is not here just to help you today live better. The scripture is here today to enlighten you today to your need of Jesus Christ. Well, I'm trying to do better. It's not going to work. You've got to get God involved in your life. You've got to let him have the chart and compass of your life. You've got to let him direct your life. You've got to let him lead your life. You've got to let him take charge of your life. Amen. Jesus said in John chapter 5, 39, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. See, the Old Testament today, the Old Testament anticipates Christ. The New Testament today explains Christ. The Old Testament today is a promise that is made. The New Testament today is a promise that has been kept. And I'm glad God keeps his word. When you read the Bible, it's all about Jesus. Wait a minute. The old Genesis is not about Jesus. Oh, yes, it is. We've spent a lot of time in the book of Genesis. We've gotten up to about chapter 26 or something like that. And we've seen in every page, in every chapter, we've seen the presence of Jesus. He's prevalent. He's there. He is prophesied in the beginning. He is the hero of the Bible. Listen, he's my hero today. I don't have any earthly heroes because people fail you. But I'm telling you, we got a God who will never fail you today. And he must be the point of every Christian's sermon. Your life is preaching a sermon every day. People are seeing either Christ in you or your lack of Christ in you. So the Bible is not a playbook for life, but it's a roadmap to Jesus Christ. Amen. The Bible is not an instructional manual today. I mean, people say, well, it's an instructional manual. It's a manual. No, the Bible today is a rescue plan. Hallelujah. David tells us in Psalm 40, he said, he inclined unto me. Oh, he heard my cry. He brought me up out of a horrible pit. He put me on a rock. He established my going. Brother, that's a rescue plan. Thank God I've been rescued from hell. I've been rescued from Satan. I've been rescued from the world. I've been rescued from myself. I've been rescued from sin because God is a rescue plan. Amen. And if you'll receive him, he'll rescue your life today. Amen. That's the power of our God. The Bible shows us a Savior who died and who bore the sins of all mankind. The whole storyline of the Bible today brings us to Jesus Christ. Second today, all of the Bible is given by God. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. So that means today what? It means it's breathed out by God. And then the context today of the Bible, the origin of the Bible, all of the Bible, it comes from God. You say, wait a minute, preacher. Now, there are different writers. There was Isaiah, Jeremiah, Nehemiah. There was Paul. There was John. There was Luke. There's different writers. They were holy men of old that God just simply uses the pen and the paper to write down his word. Let me assure you today, this has nothing to do with man's thoughts. This is God's word. Amen. And I'm glad he's given it to us today because the Bible originated in God's mind. Not only did the Bible originate in God's mind, but it was communicated by God's mouth. He spoke it. The Bible then is carried by God's Spirit. The Bible then is written by and for God's people. And the Bible reveals what? God's plan for your life. And the Bible points us to God's Son. Because the Bible is about Jesus Christ. So that we may have lives today that will bring, as we're going to preach on next Sunday, lives that will bring glory to our God. Your life should be bringing praise to his name. You should be an open declaration. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Your life should be reflecting and emitting today. Oh, what a Savior, amen. And has changed your life. Everything in the Bible is there by God's will and is for God's glory. Amen. Folks, you can't omit that. That's the way it is. So just as God spoke the universe into existence. Don't believe all this mess that scientists say. Also, God breathed out his word. You say, preacher, I just can't comprehend it. You don't have to. All you got to do is receive it by faith. Amen. So the Bible is not actually up for debate. I know today we say, well, there's a lot of controversy about the Bible. No, it's not. God said it. That settles it. It doesn't make any difference whether you believe it or not. Theologians, seminarians, churches, all are debating God's word. Hey, brother, I'm not here to debate it. I'm here to receive it. And I know when I receive what he says, it's going to change my life. It's going to change everything about me. We cannot decide what is good and what is not today. We've got to stand under the authority of God's word. So the Bible is not open for us today to choose what we will obey or not obey. Brother, you take it all or you don't take any of it. Amen. I remember when I was saved and Cynthia, you know, we had some debates about the Bible. And I said, really, you can't believe all that. I mean, really? Man, I like to go back and slap my jaws for saying some of the stupid stuff I said. But boy, I'm glad she stood firm on her convictions and on the word of God. And she said, listen, you either take all of it or you don't take any of it. Who are you to question God? I said, thank you. Amen. If the Bible is breathed out by God, then we today see God has set something for us called a righteous standard that no one, honestly, we can't keep it. Well, preacher, that means we're in trouble. Therefore, he confirms today something. He confirms that every person is a sinner today and they're under God's judgment. That's why Christ came. He came to be the propitiation for our sins, our sin substitute, that declares today one thing. The Bible's greatest declaration is this. The headline of this book is everybody needs a Savior named Jesus. And if you haven't received him, I pray you'll receive him today. The good news is God, Jesus, offers salvation to all people. Every person that will come to him, he says, I will not cast you out. I will not reject you. I will receive you. I'll make you my child. For whosoever shall call, are you hearing me, church? Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. Amen. Not will hope to be, will be, shall be. No doubt about it. Don't doubt your salvation if God has saved you. Don't listen to the lie of the devil. If God has saved your soul, you stand on that promise today. Amen. Last point. The Bible, I think, is the last one. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. The Bible is all written for man. Amen. So the Bible has a benefit. Verse 18. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, for correction, instruction, and righteousness. All right, let me give you this in about 3 minutes. The Bible is good for four things. Four things. One is profitable for doctrine. How do we deal with our sins? Well, I go to a confessional. Sorry, it won't work. You can go and you can talk to a... Well, I won't say that. Yes, I will. You can go talk to a father who's dressed like mother, but he cannot forgive your sins. I can't forgive your sins. I can't save your soul. I've heard people say, Preacher Duck saved me over at Gethsemane. No, Preacher Duck didn't save nobody because Preacher Duck can't save nobody. All I can do is, I'm like John the Baptist. Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world. That's Jesus. So how do we combat heresy? The Bible. How we say? Through the Bible. Amen. We teach the Bible so we not only know about God, but that we can know God through Jesus Christ, his Son. Second, for reproof. Reproof is Bible exposing sin. God doesn't mess around with this. He doesn't put little sweet names on it that takes away the sting. He calls it like it is. A soul that sinneth shall surely die. Amen. The scripture shows sinners are failures. Wait a minute, preacher, you've insulted me. I've got good news for you. The scripture shows saints have hope. So if you want to get off the failure line and get on the winning side, come to Christ and ask him to save your soul. So the Bible exposes sin for the purpose of bringing about a change in our life. So you can change today if you'll come to Christ. I'm glad change is available. You won't change? Come to Jesus. Third, correction. Correction in the Bible is the idea of restoring something to its proper condition. So praise God, this comes as the idea of helping a person to maybe get on their feet. Listen, folks, nobody can get you on your feet like Jesus. Amen. Correction is redemption. Correction is redemption. And correction is also restoration. He can restore you, amen. And then lastly, instructions in righteousness, or instruction in righteousness. The Bible conditions you to face life with its struggle. See, God's just not interested in plucking you out of the snare of Satan and out of the world and your flesh and the devil and sin. He's also interested in being your friend through life and guiding you and blessing you. Because you know what? Just because you're saved does not mean today that you're not going to have struggles and pains and places in your life of difficulty. But I'm glad to tell you today, on the authority of Jesus and His name and His word, thank God what a friend we have in Jesus. Thank God, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And yes, I may walk through the valley of the shadow of death, but I'll fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod, Thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. That's what He does. Thank God, He's with you through your struggles. Maybe you're sitting here today and you're one of two conditions. You're either lost or you're saved. And then today, this is something we all face. We all have struggles and trials in our life. I'm going to tell you what you need. You need Jesus. You need God in your life today. Jesus took everything that was against us, nailed it to His cross. Colossians 2 and 14 says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us and took it out of the way, nailing it to His cross. You've got to let go of your sins. And the only way you can do that is give them to Jesus and ask Him today to save your soul. The Bible says, turn from your sins, turn to Jesus. If you can today realize, one, you're a sinner in need of salvation. Two, not only you're a sinner, but you recognize Jesus died on the cross for your sins. And then you say, God, forgive me. Come into my heart, my life, and save me. And when you pray that prayer, instantly, your sins are gone. And you have become a child of the King. Have you done that? If not, I pray today. If there are struggles that you're facing, brokenness, difficulties, problems in your life today, come and let Jesus nail those things to His cross. And in turn, He'll give you victory. The question is, how bad do you want it? The call today is simply this. Come to Jesus and come now. Would you bow your heads for a moment? Could I ask you a personal question? Are you saved? Are you saved? Do you know Christ is your personal Savior? Preacher, I'm just not sure. I don't have confidence and assurance that when death comes, that heaven's going to be my home. Would you pray for me, preacher? You doggone right, I'll pray for you. And I won't do nothing to embarrass you or hurt you. I'm just asking you right now, if you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, would you just slip your hand up right now and say, pray for me, preacher. I need Christ in my heart and my life. Better yet, I got something even better for you. Would you pray this prayer with me and mean it with the earnestness and the sincerity of your heart? Dear God in heaven, I'm lost. I need salvation. I need Jesus. Forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of rejecting you. Come into my heart. Come into my life right now and save my soul. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer a moment ago, one other call. If you ask Christ to come into your heart and your life, don't be ashamed to do this. Would you slip your hand up right now and say, I made that decision. Thank God. Today I can proclaim I'm a child of God. Anyone today? Anyone? How many would say, preacher, I got struggles and trials? Let's stand to our feet. Father, I just pray right now that the power of the Word of God will draw people to altars today. Altars where needs can be met, burdens can be lifted, souls can be saved, lives can be changed. I pray right now, Lord, this song, may it touch our hearts and draw us to an altar that, God, you can meet that need.